Of you whose alarm clocks turned already for you this morning. We know that this is the Sunday when we will have people coming at various times, and there might even be some to join us 1 hour late because this is our spring forward. Despite the snow on the ground, we know that spring is coming. We are in the Lent season that reminds us of the growing nature of our discipleship and the steadfast love of God that is always coming to us, always urging us to be open to God's compassionate, healing, steadfast love. So as we begin this worship with the prelude, I invite you to take a moment to pause and to breathe deeply, to go to the Lord in prayer as we begin our worship with music.
Thank you. Let us pray to the Lord.
Reading from Genesis chapter 15. After these things, the word of the Lord came to Abram in a vision. Do not be afraid, Abram. I am your shield. Your reward shall be very great. But Abram said, O Lord God, what will you give me, for I continue childless, and the heir of my house is Eliezer of Damascus? And Abram said, You have given me no offspring, and so a slave born in my house is to be my heir. But the word of the Lord came to him, This man shall not be your heir. No one but your very own issue shall be your heir. He brought him outside and said, Look toward heaven and count the stars, if you are able to count them. Then he said to him, So shall your descendants be. And he believed the Lord, and the Lord reckoned it to him as righteousness. Then he said to him, I am the Lord who brought you from Ur of the Chaldeans to give you this land to possess. But he said, O Lord God, how am I to know that I shall possess it? He said to him, Bring me a heifer 3 years old, a female goat 3 years old, a ram 3 years old, a turtle dove, and a young pigeon. He brought him all these and cut them in two, laying each half over against the other, but he did not cut the birds in two. When birds of prey came down on the carcasses, Abram drove them away. As the sun was going down, a deep sleep fell upon Abram, and a deep and terrifying darkness descended upon him. When the sun had gone down and it was dark, a smoking fire pot and a flaming torch passed between these places. On that day, the Lord made a covenant with Abram, saying, To your descendants I give this land, from the river of Egypt to the great river, the river Euphrates. Word of the Lord, word of life.
Thanks be to God.
We read responsively Psalm Psalm 27. The Lord is my light and my salvation. Whom then shall I fear? The Lord is the stronghold of my life. Of whom shall I be afraid?
When any of the words spoken against me to devour my flesh, they, my foes and my enemies, will stumble and fall.
Though an army encamp against me, my heart will not fear. Though war rise up against me, my trust will not be shaken.
One thing I ask the Lord, one thing I seek, that I may dwell in the house of the Lord all the days of my life, to gaze upon the beauty of the Lord, and to seek God in the temple.
For in the day of trouble, God will give me shelter. Hide me in the hidden places of the sanctuary, and raise me high up on a rock.
Even now my head is lifted up above my enemies who surround me. Therefore I will offer sacrifice in the sanctuary, sacrifices of rejoicing. I will sing and make music to the Lord.
Hear my voice, O Lord, when I call. Have mercy on me and answer me.
My heart speaks your message. See my face. Hear my face, O Lord.
Hide not your face from me. Turn not away from your servant in anger. Cast me not away. You have been my helper. Forsake me not, O God of my salvation.
Though my father and mother forsake me, the Lord will take me in.
Teach me your way, O Lord. Lead me on a level path because of my oppressors.
Turn not the will of my foes, for they rise up against me. All faithlessness is breathing violence.
This I believe, that I will see the goodness of the Lord in the land of the living.
Wait for the Lord to see strong. Take heart and wait for the Lord.
Blessed is the one
Lord. The Gospel of our Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
You may be seated. Young people are invited forward. It doesn't matter where in the world you might be from. It doesn't matter what in the world might be going on. That God's people are always looking to God to make sure they know that they are going to be cared for. And that there is protection, even in the midst of things that seem really scary and violent and awful that human beings can do. So we stand with people that have gone on for generations and generations before us who called out to God to give shelter. And then we have this beautiful story from Jesus who was being warned by people that we often think of as being Jesus' enemies, but they were showing that they were being friends, weren't they? They were saying, look, you need to get out of here. There's this very powerful person who has it in for you. Right? And what does Jesus say to those folks that are saying, don't go to Jerusalem, don't go on this path that you're going on? What does he say? Right, he says, look, I know that I have to keep on doing these things that will heal people, that will allow them to be back into their communities and not be kept separate from their family members and friends because of their illnesses and because people think that they can't live together. He said, I'm going to be bringing people together and healing people and going into Jerusalem even though I know somebody has it in for me there and has it in for me so much, right? They're warning him. He's going to kill you. And he said, no, I have this role that I've been given. This is what God has asked me to do, and I'm going to keep doing it. And then what does Jesus say? Jesus gives an image. What image does he give? That I have longed to gather you under my wings. What is Jesus? mother hen. He's not even using a rooster, is he? He's saying, a mother hen, I have longed to treat you. Now, have any of you ever seen chicks and mother hens in a coop before? Have you ever seen that? And if something comes, like a dog comes up, or even you, if you're coming up and the mother hen gets a little bit fearful, what does that mother hen do? Under the wings, but and do it in a fierce way sometimes, right? And sometimes first go after that, whatever it is that's threatening, and then come back and gather all the chicks. And no matter how big it might seem those chicks are, is there enough room under that mother hen? There's always enough room. So what is Jesus trying to remind us? That no matter how far we stray, how much we might think we need to go our own way, what is Jesus reminding us? What do you think, Ethan? There's always enough room for his love, right? And his love is a love that's fierce and protective and strong enough for all of us. So let's remember that when we get scared, when we want to run away from things that we know we need to do, when we're being asked to make fun or to keep other people from feeling the love of God, we can always remember that God has room for all of creation, for all of us chicks, no matter who we are. Amen? Let's pray. Dear God, thank you for your love. Thank you for Jesus and the example of a mothering hen. Allow us to not only be protected by your love, but to share that love with others, all others. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Grace to you and peace, peace, peace from our Creator God through Christ Jesus, who gathers us with a mother's love and by the Holy Spirit. It's an interesting time. I don't know if anyone else has noticed March 13th. You think back 2 years ago, March 13th was the day that many of us heard that things were going to shut down, and that we needed to make sure we were taking care of ourselves and our neighbor with this pandemic that was going rapidly throughout not only our country, but the world. 2 years since we began to seriously grapple with what it meant to be a part of a global pandemic. And there's been lots of lows and some highs, of course, but there's been this odd sense of kind of treading water, as it seemed to have gone on forever. So much that it's hard to place things in time, at least for me, maybe for some of you. Was that 2020 that happened, or was that 2021 that happened? For many of us, the passage of time seems to have just kind of slowed down. And one of the odd and interesting and, for me, unique things of this slowing down time is that it's allowed me to be introduced to Mr. President and the Lady of the United States. Now, Mr. P and Lotus, as they are known, are not at the White House. Oh no, anyone know? They're at the National Arboretum. Mr. President and the Lady of the United States, or Lotus. They are one of 20 bald eagle nests in the whole DMV area. And that, for many of us who grew up knowing how much eagles were in danger, is just an incredible new thing that has happened. It's an incredible comeback for a species that many of us grew up thinking we weren't going to see in our adult life because of the overabundance of pesticides and how many eagles were being killed. But now, they've made this incredible comeback. because we've been careful with the use of chemicals. And so this nest that's in the National Arboretum and kept protected, you can't get anywhere close to it, but there are two cameras, camera A and camera B, that are trained on them live all the time. And we know that in February, two eggs were laid by Lotus, and there are these two cameras that every day broadcast this little family's life. It's been interesting to me to see the duties that they share, that they both sit on the eggs, they both have developed rude patches on their bellies in order for when they sit on the eggs to make sure they're transmitting that heat as closely as possible to the eggs. They both hunt for and share their meals together, and they split up the day protecting those eggs from predators. And despite each of them having unique and special roles, they share a lot of the traits and actions that are resulting in the care and compassion for their soon-to-be offspring. I think at the end of March, we are expecting these eggs to hatch. So it's very surprising to me when we think of just one of these examples in our friends, the eagles, that Christians get so angry or think it's a politically motivated move when we in the Christian church use gender-neutral or non-traditional gender descriptions for God. When the first presiding bishop of the Episcopal Church over 10 years ago preached her first sermon and used a phrase, "Our Mother Jesus gives birth to a new creation, and you and I are his children," you'd think that she had jumped off a heresy cliff by the hostile reactions that came, the articles that were published that were calling for her to recant her heresy, and the divisions that started to split even more in the Christian church by the Episcopal flavor. No one seemed to remember that Jesus himself, in the face of those so fearful of power and urging him to take the road of safety and security, referred to himself as a mother. How often have I desired to gather your children together as a hen gathers her brood under her wing, and you were not willing. We remember that this isn't an isolated instance of God being described in feminine terms. Paul refers to Jesus as Lady Wisdom, hearkening to the Old Testament use of wisdom as the divine feminine, active from the very beginning of creation, the very beginning, as John later wrote down in the Gospel of John. The ancient church fathers and mothers used feminine images for Jesus in beloved prayers, and we still use those prayers in our liturgies and in our meditations to this very day. So if we're paying attention and we're not closed off to the diverse mosaic of our Bible-based traditions, we can see the benefits of this gender non-conforming way of being in our understanding to who God is and how God loves. God is a God of great compassion and steadfast care. So much so that the fierce protectiveness of God is a gift for all humans, regardless of gender. We worship a God who, like a mother, desires to gather her children together as a hen gathers her brood under her wings. As a father who, during a Bible study, was pointed out to me a little difference when we were studying the Gospel of Luke, and as one interpreter had interpreted that wonderful story that we all know as the prodigal son. And one of you pointed out it's a father who never stops looking out for the return of his wayward son. Like a sibling who does not take the easy way out and instead takes on our most violent refusals and redeems them on a cross with a most agonizing yes. The writer Debbie Thomas said, "What Jesus the mother hen offers is not the absence of danger, but the fullness of his unguarded, open-hearted, vulnerable self
in the face of all that threatens and scares us. What he gives is his own body, his own life, wings spread open, heart exposed, shade and warmth and shelter at the ready. What he promises at great risk to himself is the making of his very being into a place of refuge and return. I'll add again and again and again. That love that Jesus shares is by its nature a never-ending letting go and being open. Letting go of fear to provide care, letting go of judgment to provide compassion, letting go of individual power and being right to find beloved community and listening to another point of view. Because our media is covering this war in Ukraine more than any other occurring around the world right now, we are seeing how God's compassionate care is still present even in the most horrific of human-made circumstances. Everyone noticed that image of the baby strollers left at the train station. The people turning their own guest rooms into places for total strangers to stay in. The paid-for reservations for Ukrainian VRBOs. Have you heard about this? Where people are going online and pretending that they're going on vacation in the Ukraine and paying ahead of time for a room that they will never stay in. But because those resources are still able to get to the people that have fled their homes, it's allowing people to help directly people who are in such need. And then we are starting to hear of the lightning fast work of churches that are mobilizing in those surrounding countries. This story was shared by Lutheran World Relief, and they started out by saying they came to this church and said, "What do you need?" And sometimes that's the simplest question that means the most. This pastor, Lukasz Ostrucza, the newly inducted pastor of St. Martin's Church in Krakow, Poland, didn't hesitate when he was asked that question. He urgently needed supplies so his congregation could welcome all of the refugees from Ukraine. And to prepare what they did with the grants they were given is to rapidly remodel the church basement in order to shelter several families. In the space of 1 week, the ordinary bathrooms were fitted with showers. They brought in beds, and workers redid the water pipes and the electrical wiring to accommodate the fact that more people will be staying there. This was a space for our parish meetings, but now it's a hostel for refugees, says the pastor, a place to sleep and to be warm. When the staff of LWR found them in desperate need, the timing was almost divine. And because of the gifts that our greater church has given them, they will be greeted with toys and milk for the children, toothpaste, toothbrushes, hygiene products, toiletries, and food. The pastor said, "We were in shock. It was like something from a movie. We never expected this. We didn't expect so many people." And the first group of families are coming from Kharkiv. And they are coordinating this 3-hour journey by bus from the border of Poland to Krakow. They will have a safe place to rest, and they won't have to worry about having essentially what they need. This church has helped refugees before. The crisis on the Belarusian border, they help people coming from Afghanistan, from Iraq, and various countries in Africa. "Everyone is welcome," said the pastor. "We hope they will feel at home." So this church hall that's been converted is now a haven. And the generosity allows other congregations to do the same. Because as you know, it's nearing a 3 million mark of the people that have fled from this country. More than 1 million of them are children. And they're in dire need. What do we need? We need a parenting Christ, a mothering and fathering God, a fierce, insistent, and protective, but with a vulnerable brood patch on the belly, God. And we see that kind of God working out that kind of care all over the world. So I ask you to join me in this closing prayer that was written by Steve Garness Holmes and that I've modified to include us all in the prayer. Gather us, Mother Christ. Gather us in from our fears and doubts. Hold us under your tireless wing. Shield us from hungers that wander. Guard us from flighty desires. Save us from the evil we would suffer and the evil we would do. Gather us with all your children, those we love and those we do not. For we shelter together, but alone wander. Mother Christ, keep us by your covering side. Tender us at your nursing breast. Close by you wherever you go, so that even up Golgotha's hill, bearing the cross with you, we are under your wing. Under your wing. Amen.
Thank you. suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried, and descended into death. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead.
I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting.
Drawn close to the heart of God, we offer these prayers for the church, the world, and all who are in need. You're invited to remain standing and be seated for the prayers as we begin with a moment of silence. You gather the church into a community of mercy and grace. Unify Christians around the globe in efforts to proclaim good news, even in the face of opposition, and to protect those whose lives are imperiled by the gospel. Merciful God,
we receive our prayers.
You create the entire universe and call it good. Help us all to stop further destruction of our planet's fragile ecosystems and amplify the calls of those who advocate for thoughtful stewardship of the Earth's resources. Merciful God,
we receive our prayers.
You raise up leaders committed to love and justice. In those who govern, nurture courage to change course when needed for the sake of the common good. Open hearts to see all people's dignity and protect the vulnerable. Implant the will to sacrifice for peace and work to an end to all war. We pray especially for both victims and victims of conflict, including in Ukraine, Russia, Cameroon, Somalia, Sudan, Ethiopia, Yemen, Syria, and all places around the world affected by conflict. Merciful God,
receive our prayers.
You hear us when we cry to you. Attend to those expecting a child, and console those who long to nurture children. Comfort all enduring post-traumatic stress. Shield those endangered by domestic violence. Uphold those who are ill or recuperating from surgery. We remember especially those on our prayer list and others we remember in our hearts. As we mark 2 years of this worldwide pandemic, be with all who suffer, all caregivers, all researchers, and all grieving loss. Merciful God,
please hear our prayer.
You kindle faith that moves us into action. Guide children and adults preparing for baptism, First Communion, and confirmation. Empower Sunday school teachers, confirmation leaders, and parents who share their faith with younger generations. Merciful God,
receive our prayer.
You welcome us into your heavenly realm. We give thanks for those whose labors on earth have ended and who now rest with you. On the final day, gather all of us with them into your loving arms. Merciful God,
receive our prayer.
Accept the prayers we bring, O God, on behalf of a world in need, for the sake of Jesus Christ.
Amen.
You may be seated. Thank you. Faithful God, you walk beside us in desert places, and you meet us in our hunger with bread from heaven. Accompany us with your living word and through this Lenten journey, that we may pass over from death to life with Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord.
Amen.
During Lent,
with our ancestors in the faith, with Christ in the cross.
We come face to face with our sin.
We struggle with our needs and those of our neighbors.
Yet we are never alone.
We are underneath God's sure and certain promises.
I am about to do a thing. Now it springs forth. Do you not perceive it?
I will make way in the wilderness and rivers in the desert.
Look towards heaven and count the stars if you are able to count them.
So shall your descendants be.
The Lord brought us out of Egypt with a mighty hand.
And gave us this land, a land flowing with milk and honey.
Now I bring the first of the fruit from the ground.
That you, O Lord, have
given me. O God, you are my God. I seek you. My soul thirsts for you.
My flesh faints for you, as in a dry and weary land where there is no water.
Oh, everyone who thirsts comes to the waters.
And you have no money,
come by
and eat.
The manna ceased on the day they ate of the produce of the land, and the Israelites no longer had manna.
Each crops of the land came in that year.
The 40 days of Lent are a journey with a promise.
God promises a fruitful table, a salvific Christ, and the end is to you. Thanks be to God.
night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread and gave thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." Gathered into one by the Holy Spirit, let us sing the prayer Jesus keeps teaching us.
Yeah.
Christ strengthen you and keep you in his grace.
Amen. Let us pray. Blessed Jesus, in this rich meal of grace, you have fed us with your body, the bread of life. Now send us forth to bear your life-giving hope to a world in need. Amen. There were announcements in the bulletin. I'm not sure if there's any that I want to announce beforehand. Are there any that
are? That's my fault. Yeah. There are announcements in the bulletin, and we just wanted to highlight our Wednesday Lenten soup supper and a brief evening prayer service here in the Sanctuary for Peace, followed by choir rehearsal. But you don't have to participate in all three. You could come for whichever you are most comfortable. But we want to invite you to participate in these Wednesday evenings. 6:30 for soup in the Fellowship Hall, 7:30 here for 30 good minutes of prayer, and choir practice begins at 8 p.m. We have today some Christian education offerings. The young people and their parents are downstairs in the multipurpose room, and I'll cop to the sin of pride. My husband, Daryl Jones, will be sharing some tidbits and some wisdom as it relates to schoolwork and planning for your future. And then the adult forum will be in the Fellowship Hall, where we are continuing in the habits of faith, talking about what it means to be growing as disciples in faith this week. And now please receive this sending blessing. You are children of God, anointed with the Holy Spirit and strengthened for the journey. Merciful God, motherly, majestic, and mighty, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, bless you this day and always.
Amen. Amen.
Thank you.